Hello, I'm Margaret Martin. If you're not familiar with me or my website, I encourage you to go to blog.mullerguide.com where you'll get lots of information on osteoporosis and exercise. Today's talk is a summarized version of a talk that I gave recently in Montreal on osteoporosis and bone health. And since it was so well received, I thought I would share it with a broader audience. So welcome. A little bit more about me. My career journey started in St. John's, Newfoundland. Although I'm a McGill graduate, I went over to St. John's, did rotations in ICU and ICU neuro rehab, then across the country into young adult long-term care. Life brought me into middle of Canada, Toronto and peds and ortho, pulmonary rehab, then onwards to 5 years in the area of health, fitness, and safety in a large corporation. Then went down and worked in California for 9 years, where I went back into the hospital setting in spinal cord rehab, burns, inpatient, outpatient, ortho, neuro, and then finally bringing the family back to Canada in Ottawa, which is where we currently are located and where my clinic, Function to Fitness, is located and the head office for MullerGuide.com. So one thing in reflecting on my career that I came to realize was that the one common denominator of all my clients was that they had a skeletal system. But so often when I was addressing their stroke or was addressing the range of motion in a burn client, I wasn't always considering their skeletal system. And so that's the purpose of today's talk, is for you, regardless of the setting that you're working in, to give a deeper consideration to your client's health. And that deeper consideration is their bones. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time looking at bone physiology, but the one thing I do want you to think about is our bones undergo a constant modeling and remodeling. And if my big toe was a good representation of my skeleton at 50, my big toe would take 10 years to totally regenerate. Fortunately, it's only going to take about a year. It's about 6 months old since my injury in this photo. But the osteoblasts and osteoclasts are always working to make adaptations to our skeleton based on the stresses of the skeleton. So in our youth, there's a whole vibrant time of bone modeling, which then starts into a more remodeling phase. And so in today's talk, I'm really wanting the message to get across of the different stages of life. And so in thinking of those different stages and keep getting an idea that would stick in your mind, and with my menopause, I went back and thought, well, what movie sticks in my mind? So Eat, Pray, Love sticks in my mind. So let's look at bone health with that same concept. Eat, move, and breed. So the nutrition that we take into our body, what we do in terms of skeletal movement and challenges to our bones, and then what is happening to our hormones. And as physical therapists, we are more in control of asking somebody what their menstrual cycle is like, if their sexual urges are more natural. We're going to be looking more at the estrogen, testosterone. There are many other hormones that impact bone health, but primarily as physical therapists, those are the ones that we should, at the very least, be paying attention to. So in today's talk, we're going to look at bone health from utero to university, from kids to careers, and these are big chunks of time in our life, but the next one is from post-menopause to post-op. And we're going to look at these stages of bone health through my eyes, because these are clients that I got to see. And so let me share with you some of their case histories. Their photos are obviously not truly them, except for some of the clients, but to protect their health. So let's start with the first picture of bone health from utero to university. Two clients that I want to bring up, Molly, who was presented to me with upper back pain, and Kim, who came to see me because of knee and hip pain, mostly in her sport, which was basketball. And so both these young ladies were in their late teens when I first saw them. Their findings on first observation was that Molly was on a vegan diet. Now, I'm not going to go into, you know, the positives and negatives of each, because this will take an hour-long talk, but know that each one of the things that I'm bringing up is because these things have either a positive or a negative impact on bone health. And Kim was on a low-protein diet, no omega-3. Both of these diets have challenges when it comes to bone health. Molly was working with a personal trainer, which technically should have been a positive thing, except for the type of exercises that she was being given that were inappropriate. Kim was doing daily basketball practice, and she had games on weekend, which is great for her bones, except that there was a disproportionate amount of energy output for her energy input. And so she was just having way too much breaking down, not enough anti-inflammatories in her diet to support the level of intensity that she was training at. Molly had irregular menstrual periods. Kim was on Depo-Provera birth control, which causes a cessation of menstrual periods. And so if you have a female who's entering like a female athlete triad type scenario, you don't actually know if their body weight is problematic for their cycle and whether or not they're entering amenorrhea. As well, the drugs have other issues. Molly presented in a teen with a kyphotic posture that was not able to be corrected, so it was quite concerning. And Kim had good spinal alignment, but with high-level sports movements, she had poor hip and knee alignment. I was had some serious concerns with Molly, so I did send her back to her doctors and asked for a spinal x-ray before seeing her again. And sure enough, the x-ray came back with fractures at T6, 7, and 8. She went on to have a bone mineral density, which showed severe osteoporosis. And yes, she was still in her teens, and then went on within 2 weeks' time to have vertebroplasties done at T6, 7, and 8. Let's look at the bone health from utero to university for Molly and for Kim. So Molly's mother wears religious coverings, significant meanings in regards to vitamin D. Kim's mom is a physical therapist, outdoorsy, a little more ability to absorb the vitamin D. Molly was premature, whereas Kim was a full-term baby. Very different in terms of the health of the bone, even years later. Molly had benign hypotonia, whereas Kim had normal growth and development. Because of the hypotonia, Molly had very limited outdoor play, no sports. She didn't actually even start walking till the age of 2, and had sustained an ankle fracture when she had started walking. And Kim was active in many sports. Molly didn't start her period until she was 14, whereas Kim started at a younger age at 11. And even the number of years within a woman's lifespan that they've had their periods is going to positively impact bone health. So lastly, Molly had a fracture at her elbow and at the patella from falling on ice. So simple, which is still considered fragility fracture when she was 15. And Kim, because of the concerns, as I mentioned earlier, in regards to the female athlete triad, and although she had a lot of good bone health leading up to her late teens, she was starting to have some negative changes and had a hairline fracture at 17. So what was the intervention for both of these young ladies? So Molly, as I mentioned, did have vertebroplasty. So following her vertebroplasty, she did work with a nutritionist. The exercise intervention was very much around modifying her daily activities, isometrics, and then gradually we introduced more weight-bearing and strength training. And an important component for Molly was the education to gain weight, to maintain her weight, to maintain her normal periods, so that she would have not only the nutrition, the eat, not only the move, the exercise, but also the breed, the hormones working in her favor for optimizing her bone health. Kim was really quick in terms of, you know, modifying. I was comfortable looking at her protein requirements, her omega-3 requirements. She upped those. She modified some of the exercises that were given to her. We worked on, you know, hip and knee alignment and She's done great. She's made the provincial team, and she one of the recommendation for her bone health was to make a consideration about the birth control choice that she made so that it would not negatively affect her bone health. So here's a great example of two young women where, you know, as a standard physical therapist, we would see them, take care of their issues, but not always regard their bone health. And so in order to allow these two young ladies to enter the next phase of life with as much bone in their bank as possible, I think as we need to make, you know, clear definitions, you know, that we are musculoskeletal specialists and we need to look at their skeleton. So let's move on into the next phase of life where eat, move, and breathe is very important, from kids to careers. A really busy time in a woman's life where whatever they choose to eat, they're often making meals on the run, and they're not only making them for themselves but for their family. The movement is, you know, very limited to activities with kids or activities when you're, you know, running to or from work. And then breed, the effect of pregnancy and lactation on hormones, and then obviously the effect on bones. So I'm going to introduce to you Simon, who is a client that I thought, wow, she really has got it together. You know, she's got a well-balanced diet. She was exercising 60 to 90 minutes a day. She had regular menstrual periods, you know, birth control was taken care of by her husband who had had a vasectomy, but she came to see me with vertebral compression fractures when I first saw her. So the vertebral compression fractures were as a result of tobogganing with her kids. Wow, you know, then you start looking back. What is it that was missed in this lady's bone health? So let's go back in her bone remodeling. So she had three fractures as a child. Obviously, no one noticed that as a red flag. So there was no intervention done other than, you know, taking care of the fractures, healing, and things went on. She was undiagnosed with until her late 40s, and she had had celiac. So many years, really, like her life, of not absorbing all of her nutrients. She had had three children, which wasn't an issue, except she had them later on in life. And she had them in fairly close together, so she had not only the year she was pregnant, but she nursed each of them for 2 years. So she had a long period of time, and then she didn't have a lot of time before going into menopause. So these are things that affect bone modeling. In her activity, it was great that she was active so much, but most of her activity was around swimming, which we know isn't as weight-bearing as it could be, and walking her dog, or her dog walking her, and that wasn't a really brisk pace. So we know we need a really brisk pace in order to affect bone health, at least at the level of the hip. And so lastly, an important thing, as a primary school teacher, Simone was always bending forward, a lot more weight bearing on the anterior vertebral body of the vertebrae. And we know in the anterior vertebral body, there are less trabeculae than the posterior vertebral body. So there's already possibly some micro fracturing occurring that was just stressed to a much higher level with the tobogganing and caused the vertebral fracture. So my intervention with Simone initially was pain management, teaching her body mechanics, safe, both for safety and for pain management. Then we went on to gait retraining and exercise, hoping that she will have enough time to build her bone back, and she's going to have some intervention, possibly HRT, things she'll have to discuss with her doctor, but bringing her into the next phase of life, the post-menopause to post-operative period, because now we know that just with, you know, strictly loss of estrogen, this is a significant time where, you know, people actually start thinking about low bone health, low bone density, osteoporosis, because of the decrease in estrogen. It's also a time in people's lives in their 50s, things start to, you know, break down. We haven't been optimizing our healthy choices, and so medications get introduced and comorbidities happen. There are many medications that have a lot of negative influence on bones. The Depo-Provera I mentioned, glucocorticosteroids, medication for anti-seizures, medication, chemotherapy meds. There's a long list of medication that can have negative impacts on our bones. And in just about any other assault to our body that affects our movements, so strokes, Parkinson's, COPD, so many things that will affect the ability to stress our bones that then obviously will lead to lower bone density. Food intake, as people get older, they're not preparing foods for their family anymore. They're just making small meals. They might not be ingesting as much protein, calcium, the nutrients. They're not out in the sun as much, so their vitamin D absorption, as well as their aging skin, doesn't absorb as much vitamin D. And then the weight bearing and strength training, if it's not been part of their life before, a lot of people don't start taking it on. So, but it is such an important thing to do, especially as we enter this last phase of life. And lastly, in this stage, most of us as physical therapists are thinking fall prevention. Great, but we need to be considering at a deeper level all of the other things that we brought up. So if you haven't met Babs before, and Babs is somebody who I feature a lot on my website, in my blogs, and she's a dynamic 97-year-old. We've worked a lot through strength training, flexibility, balance, and with Babs, she was a unique case study where I got to work with her twice a week. We worked on agility training, similar to what you do with football players, and the progression was just phenomenal. So we've started to introduce this to local hospitals, giving them services around Ottawa and Montreal, and the therapists that have been using this on a daily basis have just found it really exciting and finding really good results with their clients, and fun to do for them as well. So I encourage you to think about your bone health, whether your clients are in the stage of utero to university, kids to careers, or post-menopause to post-op. Learn a little bit more. Come and take my free course, blog.mueller.com. You'll come to this page with hundreds of articles that are you can search for in the search box, and click on the free course and encourage you as a musculoskeletal specialist to take into consideration the skeleton of your patients. Thank you very much for tuning into Mueller Guide today. It was a pleasure sharing this with you.